kind of feeling our way through things, but we're running two services, and you can come back. And some of you have been coming back every week. You've been here every week. Thank you for that, that you were able to. But next Sunday, I'll send out the protocol, which is very simple, and then also just what service you want to come to. We'll start off with meeting, depending on the crowd, between 20 to 25 people, and then as time passes and things change, we'll be able to meet all together as a group. A lot of churches that have started out slow have found ways to be creative, and they are growing in their attendance of how to get people into the building. We will do the same thing, and as the laws change. But the assembly of ourselves together is not an option for born-again believers. It's a command, and so we will continue to meet. And I am thankful for live stream. I don't know what we would do without it, but that's not what the scriptures tell us, is to assemble together in person, which is exciting for us. So remember, next week, plan to be here. And it'll be a great joy to see your faces. If you have any questions, give me a call, but we will be sending out the information that you will need to know. Let's open up with a word of prayer. Father, thank you for Christ. Certainly our hope is you. That's why we're here today. We're here not for ourselves, but we're here to worship you. Father, thank you that we can. Now, Father, we pray as we look at your scriptures today that you will not only teach us, but you will change us. The importance of knowing you, the importance of serving you is vital. And that's why you have ordained and have said in your scriptures the exhortation of your word is necessary. We find that in the Old Testament, and we find it in the New Testament as well. So thank you, Father, for the church. Thank you that we'll be gathering together next week. Bless that and encourage that. Protect our church. Protect us. Lord, work in our nation. Our nation is going through very difficult times. We pray for our nation as well. Thank you, we pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us. If you would, grab the sheet of paper next to you, and we're going to sing Amazing Grace, song number 343. I want to encourage you, many of you all watching us online, you know the song. I want to encourage you to sing along with us. When you think about Amazing Grace, the first word, amazing, we use it to describe a lot of things. But when it comes to our God, is awesome, and His grace is amazing. The grace, what we don't deserve, God's gift to us. It's amazing, and it's awesome, and we're so thankful for it. If you would, those of you here who would stand, you're going to sing song number 343, Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Was lost, but now am
verses in this psalm, and it is the longer that I look at it and read it, there is so much graciousness of the Lord found in every word, and even when he needs to rebuke his people, he does it with such love. I'm glad for that. I'm glad that he loves us so much to bring us back to himself, such a loving Heavenly Father that we have. I have listened and read this psalm probably 45 or 50 times this week. And I want to tell you, every time I read it, I find something new in it of God's goodness and his grace. Let's read it together, and then we'll begin to unpack it and look at it. And how does that relate to our life as we've been studying prayer? Let's start Psalm 81, starting with verse number 1. Sing aloud unto God our strength. Make a joyful noise unto the God of Jacob. Take a song and bring hither the timbrel, the pleasant harp with the psaltery. Blow up the trumpet in the new moon, in the time appointed on our solemn feast day. For this was a statute for Israel and a law of the God of Jacob. This he ordained in Joseph for a testimony, when he went out through the land of Egypt, when I heard a language that I understood not. I removed his shoulder from the burden, his hands were delivered from the pots. Thou callest in trouble, and I delivered thee. I answered thee in thy secret place of thunder. I proved thee at the waters of Meribah, Selah. Hear, O my people, and I will testify unto thee, O Israel, that thou wilt hearken unto me. There shall no strange gods be in thee, neither shall thou worship any strange god. I am the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Open thy mouth wide, and I will fill it. But my people would not hearken to my voice, and Israel would none of me. So I gave them up unto their own hearts' lust, and they walked in their own counsel. Oh, that my people had hearkened unto me, and Israel had walked in my ways. I should soon have subdued their enemies and turned my hand against their adversaries. The haters of the Lord should have submitted themselves unto him, but their time should have endured forever. He should have fed them also with the finest of the wheat, and with the honey out of the rock, should I have satisfied thee. Father, thank you for the scriptures. Thank you that your scriptures transcend time of the culture and the time that we are in the sense of being time-bound people, that it is relevant in every generation. And Father, we're finding that even today as we will start meeting together again next week. And Father, thank you for that, that your people can gather once again together to hear the scriptures, to encourage one another, to pray with one another, to sing with one another. Oh, how we've missed it. May we not be content on our couches any longer. Now, Father, we also do pray that you will help us today as we look at this scripture, that you will teach us once again the high priority that you have on prayer. Help us to learn as much as we can about how to communicate with you and the great privilege we have to talk to you. Father, thank you now. If there be anybody today that is listening or hearing you today in the building that does not know you as Lord and Savior, has not come to a saving knowledge of you, we pray even today they would be born again. Save the lost. Encourage the saved. Move us forward for the kingdom, we pray. In Christ's name, amen. The background of this psalm is very difficult if you're not familiar with the book of Genesis and in Exodus. And that is, this is the leaving at the very beginning here that Asaph, our author, is talking about how God delivered them from the cruelty of slavery that they had when they were in Egypt. How he freed them from them, and he led them out as they cried unto him. He fulfilled his promise of delivering them and guiding them and taking them to the promised land. And in the midst of proving them and getting them to the promised land, the problem was that they had forgotten the importance of crying out to him. Maybe you have forgotten that. The more and more I say about prayer, the more and more I am learning that it is extremely needful that each one of us are focused on God and God alone. There is really no time for anything else but work, family, and our God. And we are to be in constant communication with them. And when we drop off that communication, we suffer. It causes us to wander. It causes us to move away from him. But God, in his sovereignty, in his graciousness, and his kindness, is teaching us through the scriptures that that's why it's important that we read his word and then we communicate with him back in prayer. That is how the relationship works. When you go to work, there is protocol on how you relate as employer and employees. And if you stay within those boundaries of that protocol, things work fairly well. It's the same thing with the scriptures. God is serious about prayer. And he wants us to communicate back to him based on what he is communicating to us when we read the 66 love letters. Israel failed many times at this, and we have too. So once again, we need to take a look at the scriptures and be reminded of the seriousness that we have as believers to pray. So let's start off in our message here as we look today. Most of you are familiar with this term. You can give me a show of hands here in a second if you've heard this before. Whether you know what it means in the French language, that's where it originated from. But let me just give you the acronym for it. And if you are familiar with it, I can't see you at home, but raise your hand up if you're familiar with this term. RSVP. RSVP. Raise your hand up if you're familiar with that term. It's a term that is familiar to us as we walk through life. We see it often on invitations. You receive an invitation in the mail, and at the bottom it says RSVP. In other words, I want to hear from you based on what your intentions will be. What are you going to do with this invitation that is being given to you? Now, I've been trying to practice the French word for each one of those letters, and I am not going to attempt to do it. But go ahead and Google it. You'll see the French there. And I'm sure it's very eloquent because of the French language, if you can say it. But I'm going to just stick to the simple here. So we could say, if we just want to narrow it down, we could say the term RSVP simply means please respond. It's a plea. When you see RSVP, what that person is saying that wrote that at the bottom of the letter or had it printed on there is saying with their hands out, with great urgency, would you please respond? Now, I don't know if you're like me. Sometimes I do, and sometimes I don't. I just, put it away and I forget to respond, but it helps the host of the party or gathering that's going to take place to know how much food and how much to have and chairs, and so it helps them out. Do you plan to attend? Is basically what RSVP is saying. Please respond to the invitation. Well, God's invitation always includes an RSVP, but a little bit different. Where on an RSVP, on a general invitation, means you have to respond. If you don't, the person really doesn't know if you're coming, if you're not coming. They try to figure it out. But for when God gives an invitation that says, please respond, is because an invitation is given every time the Word of God is preached, taught, or read. So when you're reading your scripture at home daily, and you are gleaning God's Word, there's an invitation there to respond to the principle or what the Holy Spirit is illuminating in your heart. Let's just give something so ridiculous and so easy that it's easiest for us to understand this. If you're reading in Exodus chapter 20, the Bible says, thou shalt not steal. Or if you read it in Ephesians, let him that steal, steal no more. We see an invitation. And so God's invitation, when given, demands a response and gets a response every time. You either reject the principle or you respond to the principle. You either say, I'm not going to do anything about this in my life, and that is a response. Or you say, oh my, I have been stealing, or I have been lying, or I have been bitter, or I have been angry, and I see in the scriptures where I need to take care of that. So Lord, by your grace, give me what I need so that I can be all I can be. That's the prayer of God. God, you just communicated to me. And now I'm communicating back to you that I'm wrong, you're right. Help me by your grace to overcome this area in my life that evidently is out of conformity with what you would have for me. So, once again, let's remember that today as we speak and teach about prayer, you will give an RSVP. You will either say, that's ridiculous, I reject that, or you will respond in kind to the grace of God to help you in this area of your prayer life. I can't tell you enough about jumping up and down and screaming, doing a somersault, doing a cartwheel, and getting overly excited to tell you that we're missing it in the prayer life if we're not allowing Him to enlarge our prayer life. See, when a child has a limited vocabulary, that's okay. We're excited when they get mommy out. We're excited when they say three words, and we say, wow, look how large their vocabulary is. But certainly we would not feel that way when they were 12, if they only said mommy, or give me, or no. We'd say, come on. That's a little trite. That's a little ridiculous. And it's the same way you as a born-again believer. God wants your prayer life to be enlarged. He wants it to grow, to be meaty, so that when you're with God and you are pouring your heart out, it's real and it's not fake, and you have that relationship with Him. And God says, Israel, missed that. Boy, when you called on me, Israel, when you were in bondage, I lifted that burden off your shoulders. I led you out with a strong hand. I tested you at the waters of Meribah. And now look, you have gone a whoring after false gods because our communication has been broken. The Bible tells us in Matthew 22, just quickly here as we set the stage for the message, Matthew 22, verses 9 and 10, is a parable. And I don't want to take it out of context, but I believe that we can pull an illustration out of here that will help us to see through the windows of what we're talking about today a little clearer. The Bible says that, the parable is that God goes to Israel, His people, and He invites them to a wedding. And some of them say, you know what, I'm busy. I can't come. God says, wait, you don't understand, this is my wedding. And they say, I'm sorry, we're busy, we can't do it. And so when the man that comes back with sharing the message says they won't come, God responds this way. He says, go ye therefore into the highways, and as many as ye shall find, bid them to the marriage. So the servant went out into the highways and gathered together all as many as he found, both bad and good, and the wedding was furnished with guests. This text reminds us that everybody receives an invitation when the word of God is preached. And if you reject it, then shame on you. You missed out. But God's invitation is to everyone, amen, all the time, amen, always.
Amen.
Christ died for all can be saved. Those of you that are born again, God is wooing you and pulling you and trying to bring you in to have an enlarged prayer life. So that when you pray, it is really a conversation, a dialogue with God. Today we look how God asks us to enlarge our prayer life and to RSVP back to Him by saying, I will attend the throne of grace. I will open my mouth, and I know you will fill it. That you will fill it. The psalm in the that it did destroy Israel. We see the grace of God in our life, and it just doesn't destroy us with our peculiar ways and our prone to wander. I see and we see the unconditional love of God for display for his people. Just unconditional. God just kept loving them all the way through their disobedience. He just loved them. I see the attributes of God displayed through his actions. Only God can open the Red Sea. Only God can take a nation that is the most powerful nation at that time, Egypt, and allow the greatest general that ever lived, General Moses, to lead out millions of people without ever firing a shot. In fact, to the point where the people gave them the spoils so they could go. What a God. What a powerful God. What a display of our God. I see the same God, God's love displayed today to us. I hope you know that. If you're missing out, if your prayer life is meager, you're missing out on sensing and knowing the love of God. So enlarge your prayer life and respond to God is the title of the message. Our points are very simple. They'll be easy for you to remember, and they will help you to remember this message. The first one is God's plea to his people. God's plea to his people. And the second is God's promise to his people. God's promise to his people. Pleading promise. We see a plea, and then we also see a promise. Psalm 81, God's plea to his people. Our first point is simply, Psalm 81 is written by Asaph. He's a well-known nation hymn writer. If you live back in that day and you study his name throughout the scriptures, you'll see him at great events. And then you'll see those great events written in Psalms. We see that in our society. If we go back to the 60s, we see songs that came out of the unsaved world that tell us what was going on at that time. Certainly with Vietnam going on, we saw the songs were about war and fighting. And then when we see the 70s and the 80s, and the same thing with God's people, we see out of God's people songwriters that give us hymns that are so rich with theology of how great God is. That's why music becomes oldies. But God's hymns never become old because they're chock full of attributes that do not change. But this man, this writer, most of the songs go back over the history, Israel's history, and then with a monitory note. And a monitory means a warning. So this writer, Asaph, would go back, and he does this in Psalm 81. He gives us a little history. He tells us about their time in Egypt and God's deliverance. And then he begins to show a warning. Hey, listen, Israel, you better be careful. Some of you had parents like that. Sometimes before I would go out, I hadn't even done anything wrong yet. But my mom and dad knew me well enough and say, hey, be careful. And that's what the psalmist does as well. This note was to stir them up to serve the Lord afresh. We need that. That's why we're here today. That we be stirred up to serve the Lord afresh. The psalm has no exception. 1 through 7 reminds them of the Passover. And the remaining is Asaph's gentle chiding. To Israel, their ingratitude. And pictures a blessed estate of those who are obeying. Those who are obeying the Lord are in a blessed estate. The word blessed means happy. And how blessed Israel could be if they were just willing to open their mouth wide and enlarge their prayer by bringing the Lord all their petitions. Even though God already knows their needs and yours, he still calls and pleads with us to let him hear them. The key centerpiece of the verse of this psalm for me and in the study that we have today is Psalm 81:10. Listen to that together very carefully. It'd be very easy for you to memorize. If you did, I believe it would help you. If you can't memorize the whole thing, if you'll just memorize the last phrase of it, I guarantee you that will, the Holy Spirit will never allow that to leave your mind. The psalm says this. It says, in verse 10, it says, I am the Lord thy God, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Open thy mouth wide, and I will fill it. And I will fill it. Open thy mouth wide, and I will fill it is an invitation to prayer. It's not an invitation for food. It's an invitation to receive back from God what is needed as we meagerly come to Him with our prayer requests. It's like God decides to say to Asaph, and I read this over and over again, it's like Asaph shows up and says, wait a minute, Asaph, I know the Holy Spirit is working through you to write this, but I want you to move aside. I, the Lord of creation, I will take over now. No ambassador is needed to send this message. I will visit and make this invitation in person. He says, I am the Lord thy God. It's declarative. The speaker is Jehovah. And he is pleading with his people to come to him just as they are. Congregation, beloved, those that know Christ, would you come to him? He already knows your need. Just come as you are. Pour out whatever it is. How important it is to pray to God. It's the way we communicate. God restored fellowship through Christ and established prayer. It is a tangible way to see God working in your life. When you are praying with God and He's enlarging your prayer life and it's growing and you're becoming more mature and you crave those times instead of dread those times. But you can't wait to get to your sacred place. You can't wait to get alone. You see that and you say, please stop me, God. Because nobody in their right mind would do that unless the Spirit of God was stirring them up afresh. See, we see more than an invitation. It shows a great compassion and demonstration of God's love for His people. I don't know how much patience you have with somebody. Some of us have long patience, some of us have a short patience. But I'm going to tell you something, God has a long patience. The hours and the days and the months and the years of hypocritical praying and God still works on us to bring us to enlarge our prayer. And we see that in the psalm. It's an invitation with great persuasive words from God. God identifies. What a better teaser, so to say. Open thy mouth and I will fill it. We can end right there. Let's have the invitation. There's really no other reason to preach. It's pretty clear. Open your mouth and I'll fill it. How much more do we need to know about the importance of prayer? See, God identifies in the text of who He is, a reminder to those who have drifted and cast their eyes towards the world. Hey, Israel, I'm the one that opened the Red Sea. You know that burden you talk about, making those bricks? I lifted that off your shoulders. I brought Joseph to power to set the stage of getting you to Egypt so I could bring you out with a strong hand. Don't you remember that? It'd be good for us to remember how good God's been to us. Amen. It's good to remember the past. It's not good to live in the past, but it's good to remember the past. He said, how will you respond? Answer me, Israel. Let me hear your response. God says, if you open your mouth by enlarging, I will enlarge your prayer. I will fill it. Jesus says the same thing in Matthew. Matthew chapter 5, one of the Beatitudes, chapter number 5, verse 6 says, blessed, happy are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. They shall be filled. They shall be filled. The other day, Nancy and I were down visiting my daughter, which has not delivered yet, and I know she's ready. I know we're ready. And we can't wait to find out if it's a boy or a girl, and hoping that it will come tomorrow is our prayer. My wife will be happy that I say this, but tomorrow's my wife's birthday, and it'll be great for her grandson or daughter. We don't know which one would be born on her day. But anyways, my wife four, I believe, baby robins, not flying yet, with their heads poked up out of the nest with their mouth open. And I want to talk about,
it was open.
I'm talking about open to the point of, oh my, but no food was going in it. And then we would see the mother robin come with a worm in her mouth. And she would get there and she would go to one of the birds and get a little bit. And I'm watching her and I noticed the fourth one didn't get anything. Because by the time they got done with the third one, that worm was done. It was gone. But then that robin returned, showing her faithfulness to her children and fed them all. And I think that's a wonderful picture of what we have here in God's plea. He's coming to the nest of Israel, but he's not finding any mouths open. He has what they need. And so the plea is, Israel, open thy mouth, and I will fill it. Can I say to you, church, open your mouth. Pray, and God will fill it. He'll enlarge it. Jabez, whole book was written on this guy. Hardly any verses in the Bible on Jabez. Jabez is an example in 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verses 9 and 10. It says, and Jabez was more honorable than his brethren. And his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bear him with sorrow. That's been a tough delivery. That's been a tough. Some of you ladies know what that means, to have a tough delivery. And Jabez called on God, prayed. He looked at the Old Testament scriptures or what there was at that time. And Jabez called on the God of Israel. He prayed and he said, communication. Oh, that thou wouldest bless me indeed and enlarge my coast, and that thy hand might be with me, and that thou wouldest keep me from evil. Wow, what a fantastic prayer in such short words. That it may not grieve me. God granted him that which he requested. He filled his mouth. Jabez heard from God. Jabez prayed back the promises. And God said, I'll grant it. That's for you, my Lord. So God's plea is to you and I right now. Will you respond? Will you RSVP by going to the throne room of grace and allowing God to enlarge your prayer life? That's the plea. And he says that he'll fill it. Sometimes God doesn't always tell us what he's going to do. He'll tell us, you do it, and then you'll see my goodness. But here he says, you do it, and here's what's going to happen. That's a little bit easier, isn't it? When you know what's going to happen. Some things are very fearful in life. We trust in by faith. Our second point and our last point is simply this. God's promise to his people. God's plea is, hey, you haven't been coming. You need to come. I'm here in person. I am God. I am Jehovah. You come. So he gives a plea. Now he gives a promise. God's promise is found also in verse number 10. We read this, but let's read it again. Psalm 81, verse 10. I am the Lord thy God. I just love that statement. I don't know about you, but it gets me. I am the Lord thy God. He's personal. He's relational. He's giving. He's loving. His attributes are just pouring out of this psalm, which brought thee out of the land of Egypt. Can I tell you, he brought you out of the land of Egypt. Egypt is always a representation of going down to sin. God took you out of that sin of your blindness. He took you and he saved you and set you upon a rock. And he says, listen, I am your God. That's never changed. Open thy mouth wide. He doesn't say open your mouth. He says, open it wide. Make it a priority, and I will fill it. So what does it mean to open your mouth wide? I guess that's a logical question. So are we all going to be walking around like this all week? No, that's not what it means. This saying was a common custom in Oriental lands, so they would have understood it more than we did, so we need to kind of go back and take a look at where that little saying came from. Where at banquets, a guest of honor would receive the juicy part of the meat filled with fat flavor. So when it says, that term was custom, meaning that if you were invited to a wedding or invited, you were the guest of honor, it's actually the best place, and they brought you the best cut of meat, and they fed you, and it was filled with the fat and the flavor. It was a great honor to be selected. We see this with King David in Psalm 63. In Psalm 63:5, he says, "My soul shall be satisfied as with marrow and fatness." That's the richness of the bone. The marrow is important. It's the juice. It's what makes us keep our bones from breaking. It's the important part. "And my mouth shall praise thee with joyful lips." Have you ever eaten something where the kind of the grease is still there and you kind of smack your lips a little bit? That's what's talking about here. It's like grabbing and chewing on that bone. I remember my mom used to say with a steak bone, "Give it to the dog. Give it to the dog. Let me gnaw on that thing a little bit." That's the best part. So what God is saying here is open your mouth wide and I'll give you the very best. I'm not going to give you steak and fat. He's not talking about giving us food. We're not talking about that. We're talking about here that I will give you the very best, the rich and taste and glorious blessings of who I am. That's what it means to open your mouth. God wants to fill it with the best. He's just looking for a place to put it. Psalm 81:16 said this: "He should have fed them also with the finest of wheat and with honey out of the rye, should I have satisfied them." But they weren't. They rejected him. They would not open their mouth. It'd be like that robin working so hard to pull a warm, a nice, fat, juicy worm out of the ground, and she listens or hears or feels, I don't know how they do it, and they sense that warm, and she digs her beak into the dirt, she pulls that up, and she comes back to see four birds with their back to her and their mouth shut. What ingratitude. We can relate that to our own son. A great ingratitude because God wants to fill us with his glorious blessings. He wants to give us the very best. That's what God wants for his people. He wants to give you what will make you a light unto an unsaved community. He wants to give you great growth in your sanctification. "I will fill it with the diamonds of my grace." He wants to drop in those beautiful, sparkling moments of grace that we all need to continue. I will fill it with the fatness of my house. Kill the fatted calf. My son has returned. Spare nothing. Take my ring and take my robe and put it upon the prodigal son and put my ring on him and kill the fatted lamb and give him the very best. Of our God as he wants to, but when he comes to us, are our lips closed? Is our back to him? "I will fill with the very best things of my truth. I will pour into you doctrine through my word," that those truths that you and I love so much that helps us to have a burden for our community. To get up and get something done. God never called us to be accusers. "I will fill you with myself. I will come and minister to you." Wow, what a promise. That's why there's such a strong plea, because the promise is so wonderful. That's what God wants to do. What we see this verse is a contrast to what you've been doing, is what the psalmist says, Asaph, in this whole psalm. But the contrast is you're not doing this. You've been opening your mouth wide, but you've been opening it to the world. You've been watching too much CNN, and too much Fox, and too much from them. You open over your mouth to the world's philosophy. You're taking in these worthless gods. These gods are nothing. They can give you only a momentarily happiness. As always, we'll find at the end the same result: emptiness and vanity. See, the world is racing towards the tribulation period. Satan, I believe, during this virus is testing, because he only has to be ready, because he doesn't know when Christ will return in the clouds, and that's his chance for maybe victory. And so he's preparing everything that needs to be in place so that when he does come, he can move right to where he needs to go. And so constantly he's testing it and testing it. Don't get caught up with that. Stay on mission. Win people to Christ. Disciple people. The end is going to come. And Satan's always going to be testing the boundaries. Listen, if we're in the last days, and don't get all fearful when we see last day testimony, prophecies coming true. There will be a one world government. There will be a way that we can't buy and sell. But that has nothing to do with us. We're ambassadors. We're to see those things and get more into the Word of God and enlarge our mouth and get out and get the mission done. Open your mouth wide to me. I am the one who's listening to your heart cry. I desire to be your provider, your protector, and your potentate. I desire to be your all in all. I hear you when you pray. God says, I hear you when you whisper. I hear you when you can't even get the word out of your mouth. I hear you when you're crying and overwhelmed that you can't even speak. I hear you when you lay your head down on the bed, and in a still small voice you whisper, God help me. I hear that. See, those gods that you're serving, and when your mouth is open to the world, they have no ears. They have no eyes. And they can do nothing. They are no more than the figment of your imagination. A God you have created in the deep recesses of your carnal minds. But in verse 10, the Lord reminds them, I am the Lord your God. I am real, and I saved you. I brought you out of the land of Egypt. I have been faithful to you in all my covenants. Open your mouth wide. Be yearning for a great filling from your God. Luke chapter 6, verse 21 says, blessed are ye that hunger now. Why does it say now? Because we're not going to need to hunger when we're in the presence of the Lord. But right now, we have a great need to hunger after and thirst after righteousness. Blessed are ye that hunger now, for you shall be filled. In other words, you can get through any trial you're facing. God will give you what is needed. The word here means to gorge thyself. Just keep eating, to be so satisfied. God wants to satisfy you because he loves you. If you're not hungry to be satisfied by God alone, you'll be like a songwriter who wrote, prone to wander, Lord, I know it. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. You'll be content in your selfishness. God is looking for those who are urgent for him. Nowhere else can you find spiritual satisfaction outside of God bringing you the tasty warm from the ground to feed you. You don't even have to go. You just have to breathe, and God will fill you, because the Holy Spirit will illuminate truth and teach you all truth. We need to be driven from him. Just as blind Bartimaeus would not be satisfied until Jesus answered him. The apostle said, be quiet, be quiet. Bartimaeus kept yelling out, Jesus! Jesus, I'm blind! Help me! And he wouldn't stop until he got a hold of Jesus, and Jesus turned and healed him. The woman with 12 issues of blood tried everywhere. Until she finally realized Jesus was the answer and would not be denied. Or Nicodemus, who risked all to just ask a few questions. He was willing to risk all to just know who God was and how he could be born again. Maybe that's your need today. Maybe your need as you listen or you're here in this auditorium, your need is to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Jesus Christ died for you. God gave him as a gift so that your sins could be forgiven, past, present, and future, and that you could have a home in eternity, that we could take his righteousness, and impute it into your life so that you would be faultless, justified, redeemed, as though you never sinned. Christ died, he was buried, and he rose again the third day so that you could have life. And then he gave us a way to communicate with him so God could fill our emptiness. God's calling to you. Do you see your need? I think one of the greatest things of ingratitude is not seeing the need. We're okay. Know your emptiness. You're empty without God every day unless he fills you. And bring your needs to him in prayer. Come, talk to me. Open your mouth wide and I will fill it. In the book of Revelations, we see seven churches described. This allows us to see characteristics of what believers will become without Christ as the center. Each church shows a little different of a time period. The Church of Laodicea certainly shows many characteristics of today and the neglect of prayer. It's found in Revelations, if you want to take your scriptures and turn there. Revelations chapter number 3, verses 17 through 20. This is the Church of Laodicea. There's seven churches. There's probably a lot here that we can discuss as you get there. But this is one of the churches, and it kind of helps us understand some of the characteristics that the church in later days would become. Church of Ephesus says they were a working church, but they lost their first love. Sardis was another problem. And now in Laodicea, we see this problem. Because thou sayest, I am rich. We are rich. We are rich with everything. And we increase with goods. We do. We knock down our barns and we build bigger barns. We have need of nothing. Everybody in America can eat if they want to. We have need of nothing. He says, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee, says the Lord Jesus Christ, the candlestick, to buy of me gold tried in fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment, and thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thy eyes with the eye slag, that thou mayest see. It's talking to those that are unsaved and those that are in church that are saved. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. There are some ones that are saved. 18 are the ones that are unsaved. Now 19, the ones that are saved. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. And so this next verse is used often in telling someone how to get saved. But really, it is about being saved, but it's also about just getting right. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him. And we'll sup with him and he with me. Let's restore that fellowship. May we allow the Holy Spirit to open our eyes, as Asaph was telling Israel, you're missing it. You're off course. You're heading away from the way that you should be heading. In our text in Psalm 81, it says in verse number 11, some rebuking words that are very strong and very, very powerful words. Coming from the Holy Spirit in Asaph's pen, said, but my people would not hearken to my voice. So God says, listen, open your mouth and fill it. And he came to the nest, and he came to the nest, and he came to the nest, and he came to the nest. And every time he came to the nest, their backs were to him, and their mouths were closed. God could not fill them. But my people would not hearken to my voice, and Israel would have none. So I gave them up to their own heart's lust. Do we not see that in America? People say, well, he's not going to chastise us. But I say he is by the weight of our own sin. The weight of our own sin. We see it played out in Minneapolis, in Chicago, in L.A., in some of the cities over the last few days. Given up to their own heart's lust. They walk in their own counsel. Oh, that my people had hearkened unto me, and Israel had walked in my ways. Oh, Israel, 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 Israel. I came and I wanted to gather you, and I had so much for you, but you got caught up in everything else. I should have subdued their enemies and turned my hand against their adversaries. What a promise. I do not fear what's going on in America. I do not fear what's going on in the world because I'm not from this world. I'm just passing through. God has me here as an ambassador. I just want to do his bidding until he calls me home. Listen to this. The scriptures are very clear. They would have none of it. They would have none of it. How many times has God tried to revive the church? And we would have none of it. What a tragedy. What an apostasy. What open-handed rebellion this is. None of me was their cry. I want none of it. Leave me alone. Let me be. Some of us are acting that way. Prayer life is meager. God's been trying to fill us, and we're still in the same state of immaturity as we were 10 years ago. There's been no change in our life at all. We pray the same prayers. We pray the same cliches. We come to church if it's convenient. We get involved if we want to. We warm up people. But we don't really want God to enlarge our hearts. We want outward blessings. But God wants to change us from the inside out. I have been rebuked by this. I look at my life and I see all the things that God wanted to give me that I had my back to him and my mouth shut. Time and time again, God wanted more from me. And I said, no, I'm giving enough. He said, no, I want a little bit more. And I said, no, Lord. No, Lord. I am guilty. See, so we want an outward blessing from God, but God wants to change us from the inside out. Please allow God to change you. Give up the temporal. Let God fill you. Once again, Psalm 81:16, as we close. You should have fed them also with the finest of wheat and with the honey out of the rock, should have satisfied you. That we might enlarge our prayers. May our mouths be open to God in prayer. May we realize that this world, with all its trappings, powers, riches, and fame, make up what was lost in paradise. In other words, what I'm trying to say there is that God wants to give us back a little piece of paradise here on earth that was here before the fall. When it said that the devil trash can never fill our immortal souls. Oh, the longing we sense, the emptiness we know, can only be satisfied by Christ. You need a greater capacity to open your mouth wider. Open your mouth wide says that God wants you to have greater capacity. During trials, we pray just enough to get through the trial. But what about when this passes? What will change? I drove in today, my heart was sin sick. As I looked at the vendors out building large places because I guess they can serve outside of the restaurant. And so I saw them out early this morning as I came in, working to put the benches out and clean the tables so that we can get back to normal. And I say getting back to normal is repenting and getting back to church and beginning to grow again in your Christ-likeness. I hope that when this passes, we just don't go back to the way that it was. God wants us to be in a habitual lifestyle of prayer every day for God's filling. We can't do one thing without God. It's just by his grace that you're alive today. Did you know that? shower every day because you get dirty. You smell. So you take care of yourself. You're supposed to. It's the same way, spiritually, we need to come to the Lord every day and wash our feet. The very word mouth speaks of capacity. Allow God to open it farther than it ever has been before. When that takes place, you will hear things like this. William Carey prayed this. Give me India. Give me India. The country. Give me it. And he did. John Welch said, will thou not give me Scotland? And he did. Maybe we would say, God, would you please give us Hampshire? We're not even asking for a continent or a country. We're just asking for Hampshire. And God wants to give that to us, but he's waiting for us to open our mouth so that he can fill us. God's already given us Hampshire. He wouldn't plan to the church here. He's just waiting for us to take it. That's big. Because you have a mighty God whose promises are sure. God loves to fill what's empty. He can't fill what's not empty. The junk's got to come out first. He sends the self-assured away, but loves to fill the empty and the broken. He says in his word, I will never turn away from my supplicating people. I will fill them. This is my character. It is my nature. He would cease to be God if he broke his covenant. Or his promises. His promise transcends time. If you open your mouth, he will fill it. You will be changed. His provide will not be fully realized until we are in his presence. So what are you going to do with the message today? Once again, you will respond. It's not like you can walk out of here today and say, you know what, I'm not going to RSVP. I'm going to think about this. Maybe I will in a week or 2 weeks. No, God says that my preaching of my word, my teaching of my word, my reading of my word demands an immediate response. What will your response be? Will you be like the robin, the bird, that has his mouth closed and his back towards the provider? Or will you finally realize that you need to open your mouth and start growing up so God can give us what he desires our church to have? What he desires our church to have. I love our church. I don't change anything about it. That's why I'm not God. But God loves you so much, he wants to keep changing you. I think you're the best. But I know that there's some things that he wants a little bit more of. I hope you'll adhere to the scriptures. Adhere to the scriptures. Here's the invitation. Can you raise where you're at, your seat, bow your head, and take a moment and say, God, would you enlarge my mouth? Would you, and repent of maybe if you haven't? Maybe you're still as immature as you were when you first got saved. And if you're here today and you do not know Christ as your Savior, I would love to take you and show you how you can know Christ. If you're listening live stream, you can call us and I will visit to you. I will talk to you over the phone. I will explain to you how you can know Jesus Christ is your Savior. Whatever the need is, let's take about 20 seconds here and take care of that right now. RSVP, right now. Please respond. Father, thank you for the scriptures. Thank you for them. Thank you that we can look at Psalm 81. Hopefully we'll never forget it again. We'll never read it the same way. And we'll understand it better than what it's talking about Egypt, and then also the rejection of Israel and where we fit in there as well. So Father, help that to be the case. Help us not to forget to open our mouths wide and the promise that you will fill it. Help us not to forget the exhortation, the plea, the promise is found in 81:10. I am. Thank you, God. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. A couple things before we turn off the live streaming. That is, we'll be meeting together going forward, starting next week. I will send you the information soon, and then you'll be able to start coming to church, and we'll be glad to have you. And we're glad. I don't know. I can't explain everything that has taken place with the COVID-19, but I do believe this much, and that is Satan is always knocking the door to take power over those that are willing to be succumbed to his power. And this is nothing else but him preparation for what he thinks he's going to win one day, and that he's going to defeat God. And so he's always looking for the end to come. And this might be, might not be, I don't know. But for us, let's not get caught up in all the chatter. Last day prophecies will take place, and we will see that. But for us, it ought to embolden us now to open our mouths wider, so God will fill us with the doctrine we need, so that we can stay on point here. So we can stay on point here. Let's not get distracted and get angry or get caught up in what we shouldn't be caught up. Let's remember that we're to get up every day, faithfully serve our God, and make a difference in our community to those that are unsaved. Let's not forget that. Let's not forget that. COVID-19 has been blown up out of proportion. It is not exactly what they said it would be, but is anybody surprised? When has the government ever told truth? It's a power-hungry place. All governments are. And we are to look to God and make reasonable and common sense decisions through this. And we are. We're opening up the church. And we've had it open from the very beginning. And we will open it up and expect you to be here. Expect you to be here next week so that we can gather together and see the power in the hand of God.